Okay, hello everyone. This is Steve Pelletier. I'd like to welcome everyone to this webinar on successful strategies for the smart campus. Our context today is straightforward. Today our campuses are witnessing a proliferation of interconnected sensors, badges, cameras, other devices that make up the Internet of Things, and those devices are creating an explosion in the amount of data that such technology yields. So how do we make sense of that? Colleges and universities need effective strategies for managing what has come to be known as the smart campus. To that end, today we're going to explore how a campus can design strategies that derive maximum value from the Internet of Things and the smart campus, and what some of the markers of successful strategies are, and maybe what to watch for in terms of potential pitfalls. Our goals for the webinar are also straightforward. We hope that it will help you learn how the smart campus can further your institution's mission, how to develop and sharpen your own strategy for a smart campus, and how to move forward in creating and sustaining a smart campus. Our format is that we will hear from three speakers, then open the floor to questions. We hope to have 10 minutes for questions and answers later in the program. And I encourage everyone to add your questions in the attendee questions box. We won't have time to get to every question, but we'll take as many as we have time for. To get started, I want to introduce our three speakers. We're going to hear today from two campus-based experts with different experience in building out a smart campus. Tracy Smith is the Acting Deputy CIO for Innovation and Technology Strategy at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. Stephen Burrell is Vice President and Chief Information Officer at Northern Arizona University. In addition, we also have today with us Chip Swisher, who is the global practice lead for the smart solutions portfolio at the company CenturyLink. Chip is going to help us define what we mean by smart campus and will offer some perspectives for building institutional strategies. We're going to hear first briefly from Chip about what the term smart campus means. Then our two campus experts will share their insights and experiences for about 10 to 12 minutes each. After that, we'll go briefly back to Chip, and we'll go into our questions, and we'll conclude by the top of the hour or 3 p.m. Eastern time. So as I mentioned, Chip is going to lead us off, so I'll turn the microphone over to him. Chip?
Great. Thanks, Steve. So I'm just going to give a brief overview around kind of some terminologies to make sure that we're all speaking the same language and really what our focus is. As we start talking about smart campus initiatives and what's really included in there. So obviously a large explosion of new technologies, new devices, new use cases for technology that we're seeing across a whole ton of different industries. And as we continue to look at the smart city and the smart campus space, really what our focus is, and to simplify it down, is really the ability to use all of this new data that we're getting off of all of these devices, really to make the students and the faculty's job and experience on campus that much more rich. And so as we're trying to gain information from all of these new data sources, how do we create the data analytics and integrate that into other technologies so it's really seamless and invisible to the students, but yet can really enhance what they're experiencing on campus. So what are some key common elements of a smart campus? The first is really focused around wireless connectivity. And when we talk about wireless connectivity, it's not just Wi-Fi. There's a number of other technologies, and I think Dr. Burrell and Tracy are going to talk a little bit about some of those additional technologies that they're deploying on their campuses from a wireless standpoint. But really, it's all about keeping the students and faculty connected, as well as all of these new devices. Deploying technology in classrooms to enhance the classroom experience. Also, more operationally, being able to bring in technologies and new data sources around lighting and building management systems so that we can now actually improve the operations of the campus to make better use, whether it be from a social responsibility or from an economic standpoint, of resources, electrical, water, power, gas, et cetera, on those campuses to really make the university operate more efficiently. making it easier to get in and around campus using a variety of different technologies. Another one that CenturyLink and a number of campuses are spending a lot of time around is really improving campus safety and security. And so as we look at video analytics and those capabilities that are layering on, really shifting now from a focus of forensics to a philosophy of much more proactive identification of threats and incidents as they're going on campus and getting first responders out to those locations while the incidents are happening or before the incidents happen to be able to address those issues versus figuring out what happened after the fact. Obviously, from a cyber standpoint, making sure that all of these new devices and new technology that we're deploying out there are safe and secure, as well as, you know, getting additional information out. So once we have all of this data and we've been able to synthesize all of that information, how do we get that information out to the students and the faculty so that they can digest that and react to that in the most effective way possible? And so leveraging interactive signage, kiosks, mobile apps, et cetera, being able to get all of that out and in a meaningful way so that all of this information can actually be acted upon. And again, trying to drive analytical tools, we've worked with a lot of campuses. And in many cases, they have the data that they need. They just don't know how to get it to it or get it integrated together in a single data store. We worked with a large, you know, campus in the Southwest, you know, determined that over 100 different data stores that they had information, you know, ranging from spreadsheets to huge operational databases, but they all weren't connected. And so as campuses start looking at, you know, how do we not only improve the experience, but you know, how do I bring together all of this data really focused around student retention? I think as most of the campuses that are on the call realize, you know, just a small fluctuation in student volume can have a massive impact on, you know, the incremental the financials that the campuses have to actually do some of the things that they really want to do. So, you know, how do we retain 100%+ of the students on campus by making sure that they're being successful? All right, with that, I'm going to hand over to Tracy from Illinois.
Thanks, Chip. Hi, this is Tracy, as he said, from University of Illinois, and I'm delighted to be here to talk today about what I consider our journey towards becoming a smart campus and applying what we're learning for within our region and really taking a smart region approach. This first slide of mine is intentionally cluttered, and you know, I wanted to kind of present, I wanted to talk through a little bit about how we arrived at, you know, our place in this journey and the fact that it is a journey. What we have found is that, you know, everybody wants to be smart. Our provost is talking about that being a smart campus is a strategic priority. The cities around us, as an example, one of the bordering cities, the mayor and the city council put a flag in the ground that, you know, they want to be a smart city, and in fact they want to offer leadership in this space. And, you know, even our state CIO approached us and said, Illinois needs to be a smart state, and, you know, we want your help and we want your buy-in and we want some guidance on this. But yet we really didn't understand what it meant. I was at a conference once and heard somebody talking that at some point, you know, we're going to just start referring to these things as cities and campuses because, you know, we're all going to be smart, and the term smart city is just going to go away. And I believe that to be true. However, you know, at some point you have to kind of align with what does it mean for your ecosystem. What do you aim to do? What are the problems you're trying to solve? What are the outcomes you're trying to go after? And then how are you going to fund it? You know, I mentioned that we all had these strategic objectives to become smart campus, smart cities, but we didn't necessarily have defined budget for that either. You know, so that was some of what we had to work through. on our campus, we're very diverse and we're very distributed, which quite frankly is one of our strengths. However, at times it can be a little challenging too, because we find that we're having similar conversations in pockets, exploring similar solutions, and you know, we run the risk of having duplicating efforts as well as missing opportunities. You know, as some examples, our facilities and services groups have been looking at technologies for smart buildings, while in central IT, we're looking at Bluetooth beaconing and different ways to leverage location information for wayfinding and various things with our wireless infrastructure. These things are related. We should be talking together and working towards common solutions so that we don't have, so that we have a more cohesive platform for doing some of these things. You know, similarly, our facilities and services people were looking at smart streetlights, but for campus. And at the same time, the neighboring communities were also looking at these technologies. And what a missed opportunity if we got different solutions. Because again, we really want to, we're all grappling with the same kinds of things. We want to have a cohesive approach towards pursuing these things. When you consider the research that happens on campus, we have researchers looking at different ways to, you know, IoT smart devices, whether it be for energy or smart agriculture or civil engineering, or even to study how applying these things changes behavior. There's opportunities for these researchers to get applied experience, and they're wanting that kind of experience. But when we're not communicating about that, we're not making those connections and mapping them together. And they need to be part of the conversation and the solution as well. When we look at the academic side of the house, you know, as I mentioned, in central IT, we're looking at wayfinding and different location-based information, and we came to the realization that smartphones, everybody's got one. It's just really an IoT device, and you can get an enormous amount of data from that and do different interesting things with it. Kind of at the same time, you know, we're looking at student experience and aggregating different data streams, whether it be from learning management system or just habits that students have and where they're going and, you know, how that impacts academic outcomes. And so, you know, again, these are similar things that we're looking at that we should be looking and talking and planning together. And, you know, more importantly, we need to be, and we are, looking at all of the underlying things is that all of these sensors, all of the IoT devices generates all kinds of data. And we can do some really interesting things and analyze and visualize that, but how do we manage the data? And more importantly, what does governance look like around that data? And that's a big deal, something that takes time to figure out. We also benefit from regional partners, such as the Midwest Big Data Hub. And through the hub, we are able to connect with similar institutions, peer colleagues in the Midwest, where we can learn from them and the experiences that they have on their journeys towards Become Smart Campuses and the interactions that they have with the communities around them. Some of the things that we've specifically benefited from them is that, you know, we wanted to generate some buzz on our campus around some of these activities. They helped us with the hackathon as an example. Another partner would be, you know, some of the national things like US Ignite. It's a coalition of smart gigabit communities across the country, and these are opportunities to get microgrants in order to seed some prototypes. But it's really important to leverage these partnerships and to have, you know, strong vendor partners to be able to change the conversation again from, you know, we want to be smart to asking the right questions. What are the pain points? what are the things that keep the mayor up at night? What are the things that keep our CIO up at night or the provost? What are the things we wish we could do that we can't do today? And start to distill some focal points around a strategy for building a smart campus roadmap. So for us, again, it was really about coming to a common vision. We needed to, we identified some focal areas that apply to campus, but, you know, go beyond campus, because we all live, work, and play in the community around us. So safety, healthy, and the sustainability of our solutions and economic growth of our area, those are our common visions. And for, with that, we can have an engaged community where we can basically start to build projects around those focal areas. It's important that we get buy-in from our stakeholders. You know, again, we're talking at high levels, the strategic plans for being smart cities and smart campus, but it's more about getting buy-in. And, you know, one of the ways that we've done this is through community town hall meetings. We started this where we bring in, you know, and basically rally around these focal areas and start to build plans around developing these thoughts. It's important to include public-private partnerships in this. You know, our vendor partners are very key to helping facilitate these conversations and also helping drive toward, a solution framework for building these things out. I call them grassroots groups, but in our area, we have a lot of people who are very passionate and very entrepreneurial around these efforts. And it's not about centralizing their activities, but more about connecting them and being sure that we're all marching in the same direction around this same common vision. Then once you have an idea of what you want to do and you have people who can do it, then you have to figure out, well, how are you going to pay for it? And for us, it's all been all about quick wins. You know, we wanted to show value in this space. And so some of the things we've done, as an example, we have some projects we've done in collaboration with the Public Works Department in one of the neighboring cities to show we can get some value around data analysis and potholes and stormwater runoff and things like that. We wanted to have small, quick wins where we show value. We use grants. We can use donations or partnerships with our vendors to prototype some of these ideas and get some traction around some things so that once you start showing that there is value here and that there, you know, potentially are cost savings or cost avoidances, then there's the buy-in to reinvest those funds in order to extend what you're trying to do. And that's been a formula that we continue to use and that we'll iterate on throughout our journey. And so what it looks like for us is we have these focal areas, and although they say student experience, student safety, student health, these are all things that can really apply to the community. We want to improve student community experience. We want to have a safer environment. We want to have a healthier environment. We want to have smart energy. And we know that the crux of all of this is data, and so we need to have a platform, a data platform, actually a data science platform, where we can not only collect the data, but we can analyze and visualize the data, and that we have governance structure around that so that we can provide guardrails for how to use the data, what's appropriate, who has access to what, and all of that, so that we can go for some of the larger big swings in terms of civic tech and community engagement. These are values in our area, and these are the regional approaches that we are taking on our smart city journey. And so with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Steve Burrell from Northern Arizona University. He's going to talk about what they're doing in Arizona.
Thanks, Tracy. I appreciate that, and I really appreciate the discussion around community engagement and the data science platform, all really important things I think we should talk about. Northern Arizona University is a little different than the University of Illinois. First of all, we're at 7,000 feet, and unlike our colleagues down in the valley of Arizona, we get snow and we live amongst the largest ponderosa pine forest in the world. We have a very large campus, 120 buildings, and the university services more than 30,000 students. We're also in great proximity to downtown Flagstaff, and Flagstaff, for some of you who may not be familiar, is a destination vacation site. We offer skiing in the winter, and the Grand Canyon is one of the greatest and most visited national attractions, which is just about an hour away. So this is an interesting partnership that we've leveraged around our smart campus, smart communities, and have built in IGAs and MOUs with the City of Flagstaff and actually Coconino County, who also share in our interest around using smart technologies to improve the lives of citizens. On our connected campus, we're transforming education in a lot of ways that many universities and colleges around the country are. But to Chip and Tracy's point, right, it's about pulling the data together. So all of these individual kinds of activities that I'll talk about here do and could stand on their own. But as we've heard from two other folks today, it's how we tie the data together to make data-informed decisions and take appropriate actions on behalf of students, faculty, and our community visitors. Our architecture at a very, very high level is to really provide some isolation for many of our sensors and devices. We're deploying a LoRa network, which will provide an 800 megahertz spectrum, which provides great building penetration and the ability to deploy sensors into locations where we may not have hardwired connections conveniently available to the network. We're also building out a 5G infrastructure on campus in collaboration with two other commercial providers of 5G networks, and of course our own Wi-Fi network. But pulling that back and using CenturyLink's recently announced edge computing capabilities allows us to fulfill largely a cloud strategy here to do all of this compute and storage on the edge of our network. We have been using Splunk and to Chip's point, spreadsheets and other things in the past. Splunk was great and continues to be an important thing, but we're really looking forward to the capabilities that ThingWorx can bring to this to do that. And also, to Tracy's point, we recognize that, you know, the smartphone and the student is actually a sensor platform in and of themselves and also an outlet for information, which, you know, this smart campus environment can be used to control things and provide guiding information to those students. So very high-level architecture of how we're approaching the larger problem. So, you know, what are some of the smart initiatives at NMU? Well, some of you may have recognized that we're one of two or three institutions that are using delivery robots. They're currently delivering food to people around campus, and we have about 40 of those that are active at any given time. And a long list of other things. Bus route management is something that we've done. I'll talk about a little bit more in a minute, but how to make the bus route more efficient. Parking enforcement using camera technologies to do a better job of parking enforcement and making sure that parking is working for everybody. Taking gates at dining halls and in our activity centers so that we know what students are using those in more near real time. And combining those back into our Salesforce platform in order to create actionable intents, having processed those with Splunk and soon perhaps ThingWorx. But the idea there is to monitor students' use and perhaps the discontinuation of their use, which might signal an issue or a problem and an opportunity for us to intervene on behalf of the students' experience and progression here at the university. Again, we develop our own NAU Go smart app, which in fact is a sensor platform, and we use that quite extensively asset tracking, and we're recently redone and on the cusp of launching a new lighting project across the university so that we can be better participants in our dark sky community. So the benefits and impacts of this, I think, you know, we can all imagine what they might be. One of the unintended benefits of this food delivery service has been we had some international students who were here, and though they indicated they had been vaccinated for, but had evidently not been vaccinated for smallpox, chickenpox. Oh, that'd be really bad. Chickenpox. And so we had to isolate these individuals in their residence hall rooms, and the robots provided food and medicine deliveries to them. So really great use of the technology for not just delivering coffee and food to students for convenience, but really to maintain good practices around student health. And lots of other opportunities, of course, coming out of the benefits and impacts of this. How we've developed and implementing a strategic vision for Smart Campus has been, again, to Tracy's points, through partnerships, extraordinarily important. The Vice President for Capital Planning and Facilities, our Chief Business Officers, the Vice President for Students Affairs, and myself have basically committed to the ideas that, for example, any renovation or construction project will that requires IT funding, and that we will be putting in smart technological capabilities, even if it's just infrastructure to start with, in any place that we touch or build in the coming years. Also, as part of our IT strategic plan, instead of the traditional five-year plan that many of us grew up with in higher ed IT, we've adopted the 18-month sliding window. And again, this allows us to be a little more agile in terms of aggressively implementing infrastructure, as you see there, and in our partnering. And CenturyLink has been a great partner in that, both for the city of Flagstaff, Coconino County, and the university, who share many of these instances. We've also signed an MOU, an intergovernment agreement, with the city to join networks and to share conduits and those kinds of things, which really make, when we can overcome those right-of-way issues, it really speeds up the advancement of things. So, and then we created a sense of place. Unlike University of Illinois, we are 100% IT centralized, so with great power comes great responsibility. And so one of the things that I've done to bridge, as Tracy was pointing out, the interest among researchers, student affairs individuals, technologists, and even our community partners is to have an IoT center for the development of these technologies and testing, and just really a playground for people to try out different kinds of activities and sensors. Again, you see our NAU Go app on the left there, successfully envisioning, creating, executing a strategy. It's all about alignment. Again, my colleague from Illinois pointed this out. Can't underscore that enough, that the alignment with strategic partners, both internal and external to the university, are extraordinarily important for advancing your smart campus directions. And overcoming barriers, I think, first of all, pilot projects are great ways in higher education and with cities and communities where the university can take sort of the political sting and risk out of these kinds of projects with governing boards. But, you know, begin telling the story to, from others' point of view, being transparent about the privacy conversation, building student advocacy, engaging community partners again, whether it's the city or for us it might be the Lowell Observatory, for example, here in town, and then integrating IoT as part of your institutional strategic plan. Here's a quick shot of our on our bus yesterday. And I thought this was an appropriate slide and concept around with benchmarking and assessing. If you're trying to save money, do what my grandfather taught me about to carpentry, and that is measure twice and cut once. For example, you also want to make sure you're measuring the right things. Our transportation services thought that, you know, the number of riders was actually the best metric. If we could increase ridership, then, you know, we could serve the students better. In fact, really, what was at stake really was the reliability. Could I rely on a bus coming every 3 or 4 minutes? And that was actually the measure. And that's what this particular smart system does, is it spaces our buses around campus. And we have as many as, in this particular line, 15 buses running at once to make sure that they are appropriately spaced out and running. So, you know, asking the right question, I think, is really important about that. And there are many risks, and I love this one. This one happened a few days ago. You can see one of our food trucks on campus ran over, backed into one of our delivery robots, and a student texted out, the truck just murdered one of the robots, rest in peace. So there are risks associated with this. You can see the other robots have gathered to see how their friend is doing and to provide some support. But, you know, in all seriousness, security of data is a big issue and a risk that needs to be carefully managed. All the issues around privacy, complex systems fail in complex ways, so I think keeping things as simple as possible is a way of mitigating some risk. Rogue IT, rogue IoT in particular on campus, for those institutions that are highly distributed, it's really kind of tough to wrangle in and make sure that, you know, people are doing things according to policies and that the collaboration is there. And I think introducing, you know, as we get into more AI around using the data on top of that, the certain conversation around AI biases and are we actually being too smart with our technology is an important thing to keep on your agenda. And then I would also add just accessibility. Can everybody access it? So in summary, institutional and community engagement, adoption of the entrepreneurial spirit, you know, not being afraid to take a few risks and try some things, developing policies to guide IoT and address the privacy on campus, develop and address identified use cases. Again, Tracy pointed out, you know, find willing victims, I guess, would be the, you know, the appropriate clause here. Find people who are willing to take that journey with you and go do it. Integrate those smart discussions in institutional planning, adopt great partners, and architect for security and scalability, because I think one of the things that's going to happen very quickly in this area is it's going to scale. Future things we're looking at, lots of fun things. I think we're talking about larger delivery robots on campus. We're talking about like bringing smart home features to the campus so that you can customize the environment of your office or environment of a perhaps a seminar room or even a classroom. Doing on-demand traffic control. We don't need traffic control except during the 5 or 6 class change periods during the day. So how can we do that without necessarily putting humans at risk, I think, is a really smart way of addressing some things on campus, and you can see the rest of the list there. Proximity-based visual signage is this is a concept we have currently underway so that, you know, your particular interests may be viewed as you travel about different buildings on campus on our smart signs. And that's pretty much it from NAU's point of view, so I think I'm handing it back to Chip at this point.
Yes. All right, so as we look at the Smart Campus journey and one of the topics that I was asked to really dive into a little bit is, you know, how do we get engaged? How do we get a Smart Campus initiative going on our university? And I think it's both Dr. Burrell and Tracy alluded to. You know, the first big part is around planning, and I spend a lot of time working with universities and cities, and the one thing that I talk a lot about is you know, identifying the right things to go after. And so if you look at from an IoT standpoint, and this is an anecdotal metric, and I haven't been able to prove it out 100%, but I say somewhere around 80% of the IoT technology out there is technology looking for a problem to solve.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the first thing I spend a lot of time with is, you know, especially when I'm working with large customers around large programs, is really understanding what is your business case behind that technology. And so, I'll, you know, implementing technology for technology's sake is not the right approach, because bottom line, at some point along the way, that program is going to get blown up. Your stakeholders aren't going to be aligned, whether it's financial or from a business standpoint. Why are we doing this? And so, the key thing is upfront, really understanding what it is we want to do, what are we expecting to get out of this, what are the financial metrics and business metrics behind it, and how do we get everyone aligned that this is the right thing to do, and how do we get moving forward? So again, so you're not focused on technology initiatives that really aren't ever going to get legs within the organization. And then once you have that, it really comes down as well to planning. Is what is our roadmap? I think Dr. Borelli, it's first thing I see in is 18-month rolling plan. But that's really what we're talking about here is staying agile. The technologies that you're dealing with here are also evolving very rapidly, and so things that you could do today, you couldn't do 12, 18 months ago, and even, as we look into the future, the technologies are going to continue to evolve, and things that are going to not make sense today, may make sense in the future as technology evolves. But, having a solid plan around, not only what your overall strategy is for the campus and the infrastructure that you're putting in and how that's going to support your initiatives, but, looking at the individual projects and making sure that you've got a solid plan for rolling those out across the campus, or in the case of both Illinois and NAU, across the community overall, because campuses really are a key element in a community. I talk a lot to cities, and they ask me, well, how do I get these initiatives going? I said, well, do you have a campus? because really I see the campus environment to really a massive engine for getting these types of initiatives going, and not saying that all campuses are perfect from their ability to have less bureaucracy and things to push through, but in comparison to some of the cities that they operate around, I think are a little more agile and willing to take risks and move things along. And so those are key elements as we look at how do smart cities evolve and smart districts evolve. We really see the campus as a major a catalyst and incubator for a lot of these technologies. And then obviously you've got the final element is continuing to learn, from your mistakes and your successes, and applying that into, what do we do next? And how do we leverage everything that we've done to evolve into the next generation of what makes sense for us within that overall technology journey? So, all right, I'm going to hand it back here to Steve, our moderator, to open up for questions and other discussion.
Thanks, Chip. I see that we have a number of questions in the attendee questions box. I'm going to take them perhaps not in order, but I want to start with a macro question that's in the box. It's asking for some clarification and sort of further conversation about what issues you're trying to solve with IoT smart building and smart campuses. And maybe I'll ask Dr. Borelli and Tracy to each take a crack at that question. What issues are you trying to solve going down sort of the smart campus journey road?
Well, I'll jump in if Tracy doesn't mind. I think when it comes to smart building, smart campus, first of all, I would tell you that we're really interested in turning the building into instrumentation. So collecting data about our buildings, from how much energy they're consuming to who's using them, to being able to put technologies in that transform their particular uses at different times of the year, such as smart signage, doing things, again, like smart scheduling, the ability to walk up to a building and schedule it or schedule a room on your phone, the ability to implement restrictions on our research buildings where we're doing ITAR class research from certain individuals from being able to access or permitting access to certain areas. All of that data comes into play to identifying how the university and how well the university is using that facility. And then if we take that and we take it across campus at scale, now I can understand how my campus is being utilized, what the flow of people is, how efficient or how effective we're being in using it. It informs scheduling, to informs capital plans and master plans. And so I think in a microcosm, right, many of us would say, well, we're already kind of doing that. The key, going back to what Chip and I think Tracy mentioned, was the collection of that in a smart way around data and thinking of the building as instrumentation really informs our long-term practice as a university.
And at Illinois, what we're trying to get at is, you know, if you look at student experience, we're trying to make things easier. We're trying to make our environment healthier and safer. You know, one great example that we're currently engaged in right now is this notion of a student experience app. We're establishing building blocks with various data streams, various data sources, and creating this open source environment on which we can build different capabilities. And one of these is it's taking the notion of fan experience like you would have at professional stadiums, but applying that to students and student experience with an aim towards, again, making it easier for students to do what they need to do, but also with an aim towards improving academic outcome and making them more successful.
Very good. We'll move along to the next questions. We've got a couple questions that are really about definitions and vocabulary, maybe semantics. One is very specific. What is beacon technology? Evidently a reference at NAU. So that's a question for Dr. Burrell. But there's also a question about asking for the definition of smart technology versus maybe the smart campus. So maybe I'll ask Dr. Burrell to kick off a response to those questions in tandem.
Sure. I think Tracy also had mentioned the use of beacon technology. Basically, this is technology that can be used either with GPS-type coordinates or wireless access point affiliation, or, you know, more easily perhaps through Bluetooth-type devices that you can put in various places, which when a student comes into proximity with that, with, say, like our NAU Go app, they get push notifications about things. So, for example, a pretty simple one is a marketing one where you'd put a beacon somewhere near the bookstore, and if the bookstore was running a special on, a clearance sale on, you know, NAU swag, they could push that notice to the student and have them come in and take advantage of that deep discount that day. It might be also pushing menus, for example. As students move around campus, they come in proximity to the dining hall, and the smart sign might display it, but it might be more easily read on a student's phone as to what today's menu is. So beaconing technology in that context, you know, can take on a lot of different applications, but it's really a proximal technology with a push. And let me just pause there. Tracy had also mentioned that at Illinois, so maybe it's a good bridge to her.
Yeah, similarly, we're using those kinds of things for kind of intelligent, adaptive wayfinding, as well as push notifications for various events or things that would be relevant to the person walking by.
And I'll just add from an AU standpoint, we're also thinking about using that particular technology in conjunction with some others to take attendance in class. We have a policy that 100 and 200 level courses all have to take attendance. And so, you know, it's a big burden on faculty member. If we can find a reliable, consistent way of doing that, then, you know, maybe we can change the faculty's experience as well.
Yeah, it's also, you know, it's also very valuable, you know, just, and then Tracy mentioned this from a wayfinding standpoint, you know, one of the challenges, you know, the two main ways that people try to do wayfinding are using GPS or using beacons. And the challenge with GPS is it doesn't help you in terms of determining elevation. So if you've got a, you know, a 5-story, 10-story building on campus, GPS will tell you where you are approximately within the building, but not necessarily which floor you're on. So being able to get much more pinpointed in terms of accuracy in terms of where somebody specifically is.
So what was the second part of that question?
The other question is about definition of smart technology. The question is a little broader than that, but in the interest of time, I'll pare it down to that piece. The difference between maybe smart technology and smart campus, sort of clarification of vocabulary and definition of terms, maybe?
Go ahead, Jim.
Sure, yeah. And so when we talk about kind of smart technology, we talk about, you know, multiple different layers that all have to come together in order to, you know, satisfy a given use case. And so, you know, it includes wide area network communications. It includes local area network communications. It most often includes wireless communications. So we talk about, you know, cellular, Wi-Fi, and other LPWAN technologies such as LoRa or NB-IoT coming into play there. It includes smart devices. And so more, you know, generically, you know, any device that's generating data that you're capturing across that wired and wireless network. And then you're capturing that data, you know, either on campus or, you know, in some cloud location where you're doing data processing, data reporting, and data analytics on that information. So data processing could very simply be, you know, I have a parking sensor that, you know, a car drove over, and now I know that that space is occupied, so I need to go and update a counter in a database and push that out to a sign that says that status has changed. You know, from our reporting side now, I can go do reporting on the aggregation of all of that data over time to know, you know, trending, how many spaces were used throughout the day or in a given hour, you know, or during a given week, you know, how is that being utilized. And then analytics is really going back to some of the things that I talked about before, when we talked about, you know, large universities with multiple hundred, you know, potentially 100+ different data stores now, is how do I create, you know, the 1+1=4 by integrating in, you know, data from multiple different data sources that maybe I hadn't even thought about pulling together and how they were related, but bringing them together in new and inventive ways to actually create something that's greater than the sum of its parts. And then finally, how do I get that data out and out to the people that are interested in knowing about that data? You know, so do I have mobile apps? Do I have digital signage? Do I have other data stores, et cetera, that allow me to push and get that information out? And so all of those are really elements now of making a use case happen, or an integration of an overall set of use cases in order to make a smart effort successful. And so as I look at all of those different elements, you know, also I look at how can I reuse some of those elements across use cases. How do I reuse that same network connectivity and wireless connectivity to support all these different use cases? How do I intelligently deploy these devices across campus in the most efficient way possible?
Good. Let's move on. Sorry.
Okay.
Please, go ahead, Tracy.
I was just going to add that, you know, the smart campus component of all of that is taking all of that data collected and computed and analyzed and making decisions to improve your environment, to improve outcome.
Good. We've got a couple questions that sort of dive into strategy, maybe specific elements of it. The first question is, how important is it to have a master utility infrastructure or fiber plan that is robust and is designed with the campus master plan in mind? Thoughts about that?
Well, this is Steve in AU. I think, you know, a fiber plan should be part of any strategic plan that a university, particularly a large state university in an urban or rural area, is going to implement. On the other hand, you know, your IoT strategy doesn't necessarily have to have robust fiber, you know, in order for you to work. Again, think about, deploying LoRa and then backhauling that data from the LoRa gateway using a 4G or a 5G a card, you know, into another network or even into a copper-based network. I mean, there's a lot of ways to maximize IoT capabilities at the edge without having to invest huge amounts of money in your core.
We're going to drill down, and we've got some rather specific questions. One is this: can anyone speak to approaches they took to identify and select their data warehouse platform, the platform used to aggregate and analyze all this data? Question is says big data platform or traditional data warehousing, complexity versus resources, talking about dollars and staff. Kind of a broad question, but also a little specific. Any thoughts about that one?
We're in the process of actually building a data hub. We have the traditional data warehouse for some of our administrative data. It's about collecting and aggregating our data into a data lake, and that's the strategy that we're taking.
Similarly, a specific question is about attendance-taking technology. Any specific thoughts about that piece of this mix?
I think the question was about, you know, how we're doing it today. We are trying a number of different things here at NAU, including beacon technology. We're trying smart phone app technologies that allow students to kind of self-report that using, I think as Chip and Tracy pointed out, the smartphones in their hands. We have been, up to this point, been using prox readers and the student's ID card to collect, you know, mass amounts of data every day from a number of prox readers that we would put in our largest, even medium-sized lecture halls. And so, you know, there's pros and cons to all of that. Usually the one comes up that says, well, you know, what prevents somebody from handing somebody their ID card and keying in? Well, you know, it's the same thing I did back in the 80s when I was going to Colorado State, is we just raised our hand twice and said, here, you know, to represent our friend who couldn't make it to class. So, you know, it's all imperfect. I don't know that we'll find the perfect solution, but we're trying to find the one that, you know, kind of augments the student's experience, to Tracy's points, and doesn't disrupt class and is reliable in the context from the faculty member's viewpoint. So prox cards is our current official method, and we're experimenting with lots of others.
There's a question about return on investment. The question is, I would like to understand the ROI on these smart apps and technologies. How do you sell this to the university to show how this benefits students, faculty, and staff, and visitors? How does this make it to the top of initiatives of the university as a whole? What drives this dialogue?
For us, with our mobile app approach, it's very much been about establishing vendor partnerships and getting sponsors. But basically, the real story is, how useful is it? Are people using it? Are they return visitors? Are they spending time in the app? Again, we take more of a incremental approach. We show some success and then invest a little more and show some success and continue to grow it out that way. And that's been the formula that works well at Illinois.
And I guess at NAU, right, we partnered with the student affairs office and asked them what kind of problems they wanted to solve. Enrollment management wanted to kind of minimize the summer melt, so we put the app out there in front of students from a very early engagement stage with the university, and did some communication programs and some other things across the Smart app to reduce summer melt. Then we transitioned to matriculation, onboarding. And so for us, it was about a student engagement, retention, progression, and graduation initiative. And we threw out the old stuff and started brand new and built it with student opportunity engagement all the way through.
We've got about 5 minutes left, maybe time for one more question. This is also kind of a broad question, but I think it's important. It's about funding. The attendee rights capital funds are usually not hard to find to fund these projects. How is the university finding refresh funds to keep these technologies upgraded and supported over time?
I'll go first and say that NAU ITS is on an OPEX model now, so all of our refreshment is built into our OPEX budget, and that was not easy lifting. I lost some battles, I won some battles, but I think taking an OPEX approach to this and talking about sustainable technologies, sustainable programs from the very first conversations is extraordinarily important.
Agreed, and we're not quite to the fully OPEX environment here. However, our strategy is again, to show wins in terms of cost savings and cost avoidance, and just the sustainability plan is to reinvest those savings into these platforms.
All right, maybe time for one quick question. This is IoT requires an integrator, knowing all of the special systems and how they work as a silo and how they work integrated. How is the university planning to address this IoT subject matter expert need to support smart technologies or smart buildings and the smart campus? So it's a question about maybe staffing.
Well, I made a strategic decision to reallocate resources from other areas of technology that did not have the same promise and lifespan that IoT and smart campuses would bring. So I think in one of my slides I said it may be about more about the question of what you stop doing on your campuses in order to start doing some of these initiatives, and that's exactly what the decision was for me. So I have an IoT Center Director. He's actually tied to the research side of things. That's purposeful, and we're integrating other staff and graduate students around that individual and the lab as a nexus for developing smart campus.
And in our open environment, we really see our place in that ecosystem as the caretakers of the data, so the data science place. We are the ones who do the analysis and provide the reports and the visualizations of the questions you seek to address through the data.
Okay, we're going to have to call an end to the questions. They've been excellent questions, and I'm sorry we didn't have time to take more of them. But thank you, everybody, for participating. There is a question about whether a copy of this presentation deck will be sent to participants. I know the webinar and the deck will be available after the fact, so that will be available for you to access. So with that, I want to thank our sponsors and our presenters especially, and you participants, and I hope this has been valuable. And with that, we'll conclude this webinar. Thanks much, everybody. Bye.